Before going to today's topic, I'll just finish off the remaining part of yesterday's part. So I was dealing with the autoimmune hepatitis and cholangiopathies. Hepatitis I've completed, now about cholangiopathies. Cholangiopathies means the bile duct is affected. The term cholangiopathy comes from the bile duct epithelial lining, which are called the cholangiocytes, and from there cholangiopathies. Now, as I had discussed in the first lecture, about the anatomy of the bile ducts. It starts from the ductules, and ductules ultimately drains into the conducting or septal duct and the segmental duct, and then the main hepatic duct. So the main hepatic duct and up to the two second or third branches, it forms the large duct system, and the primary sclerosing cholangitis is a disease of large bile duct. While the primary biliary cholangitis, another sort of autoimmune cholangiopathy, is a small duct disorder. Now, what is the difference between the two? Now, it is usually seen that the autoimmune disorders are more common in females. Autoimmune hepatitis was also more common in females. And like that, primary biliary cholangitis is also more common in females. But primary sclerosing cholangitis, that is more common in case of males. And usually you will find an associated history of inflammatory bowel disease in case of primary sclerosing cholangitis. On the other hand, primary biliary cholangitis, a female will be having association with some other autoimmune disorders like Sjögren syndrome, thyroid disease, scleroderma, or any other connective tissue disorder. Now in serology, there's the AMA is strongly positive, and strong association is there between the anti-mitochondrial antibody, 95%, that is 95% specific for primary biliary cholangitis. So if a female patient comes who is already having history of some other connective tissue and is also having history of, say, some liver symptoms, like she has pruritus and then jaundice or hepatomegaly, and then we perform the serology and we find that in serology this AMA is positive, then we can think in the direction of primary biliary cholangitis. But in case of primary sclerosing cholangitis, it is not, the markers are not that specific. The association is with that of ANCA, that is anti-neutrophilic cytoplasmic antibody, and ANA is also positive. ANA is very non-specific marker. It can become positive in any of the connective tissue disorders. Now, in radiology, primary biliary cholangitis will appear normal, while the primary sclerosing cholangitis shows a classic feature of alternate bleeding and constriction. So, radiology gives a great clue for the diagnosis of primary sclerosing cholangitis. Now, coming to the pathogenesis of primary biliary cholangitis. I said that this is a disorder of the small bile duct system. Again, as it is an autoimmune process, there will be some genetic association, there will be some infection, after which infection or some other autoimmune diseases are there, and because of which some molecular mimicry develops, and an enzyme which is present in the cholangiocyte, that is the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, the E2 component of the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, that behaves like an autoantibody. So if anything is detected as an antibody, it will be taken up by the antigen presenting cell. Then like any other immune mechanism, it will be presented to the helper T cells. Now the helper T cells will in turn activate either the cytotoxic T cells, which will cause damage to the biliary epithelial cells, or in turn it will activate the B cells, which will release the immunoglobulins from the plasma cells. In this case, anti-mitochondrial antibody is released from the plasma cell, which causes further damage. And that's why in serology, we see the anti-mitochondrial antibody. In serology, that is done by a procedure called the immunofluorescence. And this green dots are there. There's a pattern of staining. For different connective tissue disorders, we identify the pattern and we say that this is an anti-mitochondrial antibody or anything else. Now, what we see in histology? In histology, the classic description is that the portal tract will obviously show lymphoplasmacytic inflammation. As it is a cholangiopathy, the bile duct will be damaged, and there is also a granulomatous response against it. granulomatous bile duct damage, that is a histological hallmark of this disease, primary biliary cholangitis. However, it is not that always you will present a granulomatous response or something like that. Sometimes what happens that the damage has already occurred and the bile duct has been completely destroyed and it is absent in the portal tract. So an absence of bile duct in the portal tract in the presence of a compatible history AMA positivity, that will also provide a hint towards the diagnosis of primary biliary cholangitis. And as you can see in this diagram, this is a bile duct epithelium. The in normal bile ducts, the small bile ducts are lined by the cuboidal epithelium. So you can see that the epithelium is not that regular. It is showing some degenerative changes, some irregularity, and there is infiltration by the neutrophils. So this is an evidence of bile duct damage. So this completes your primary biliary cholangitis. Now the other associated features which can be found is there's a terminology called chelate stasis. Now bile ducts are damaged, but the adjoining hepatocytes also bear the brunt of the bile duct damage. So what will the periportal bile duct show? It can show swelling, as can be seen here. It's swollen and the cytoplasm appears wispy. And there is deposition of copper, as can be seen here by the black deposit. This is an Orsini Shikata stain, which is used to stain copper. Now, copper is also excreted through the bile duct. As it cannot be excreted, there is deposition of copper also. And also, gradually, there is deposition of bilirubin within the swollen hepatocytes. So, this deposition, the swollen hepatocytes along with the bilirubin or bile deposition, this is called as feathery degeneration. And this entire spectrum of hepatocyte swelling with deposition of copper, with bilirubinostasis or bile stasis, that terminology is the chelate stasis. Now coming to the second cholangiopathy, that is the primary sclerosing cholangitis. Now, as the name suggests, there is sclerosis. Now what is the pathogenesis? This is also an autoimmune mechanism. So apart from genetic susceptibility, some HLA association, another thing which what has been seen is that it has a strong affliction in patients with inflammatory bowel disease. So what happens in inflammatory bowel disease, the T cells which raise a response in case of inflammatory bowel disease, these T cells, it has been proposed that these T cells migrate into the portal circulation and then they reach into the bile duct epithelium. And in the bile duct epithelium, first of all, they will cause this biliary damage. And when it is long-standing, there will be modification of the stellate cells of the hepatocytes, which will change to myofibroblast. And also the portal myofibroblast will be laid down, will be increased in number, and this will cause sclerosis in the bile ducts. So what we will see in histology, the classic picture is that we will see layers of concentric sclerosis around the bile duct. So this is called onion skinning fibrosis. As can be seen in Mason's trichrome, we can see that there is intense fibrosis around the bile duct. But again, what happens is, as this is a disease of the large bile duct, in liver biopsy, we usually do not sample the large bile ducts. So we have to get a clue from the medium or small bile duct. Suppose a little bit of inflammation is there, and some evidence of bile duct damage is there, and also the bile duct is missing, but there is no concentric fibrosis. Still, if the patient is a male patient who is suffering from IBD, and we have a ERCP or MRCP image which shows this bleeding appearance, that then we can suggest a diagnosis of primary sclerosing cholangitis. Now, this is a photo radiograph of ERCP, that is enterograde cholangiopancreatography. Then this shows this alternate. You can see this is the normal portion. This portion is concentric. Again, this portion is concentric. So this gives a beaded appearance. So what we will find in lab diagnosis? In lab diagnosis, in both primary sclerosing cholangitis and primary biliary cholangitis, as these are cholangiopathies, there will be accumulation of bile salts. There also the patient may present with itching. Then when there is hepatitis, there will be right upper quadrant pain. fatigue and jaundice. So these are non-specific symptoms you can find in any hepatic pathology. Now, what will happen in the liver function test? The GGT and alkaline phosphatase, which are located in the cholangioles, so this will be markedly raised as compared to ALT and bilirubin. Autoantibodies for primary sclerosing cholangitis, it is the P-ANCA or smooth muscle antibody. But the gold standard for diagnosis is radiology, either a magnetic resonance cholangiopancreatography or ERCP, which will show a characteristic beaded appearance. Now, this is to summarize what are the autoimmune diseases. Autoimmune hepatitis we saw yesterday. Today, we saw primary biliary cholangitis and primary sclerosing cholangitis. Another entity is there, which is autoimmune cholangitis. Now, all show female predilection except for primary sclerosing cholangitis, which shows a male predilection. Now, autoimmune hepatitis, as it is a hepatitis, so the hepatocellular enzymes will be increased like AST, ALT, and the rest all are cholangiopathies, so alkaline phosphatase and GGT will be elevated, more elevated as compared to AST and ALT. Now, this is an autoimmune disorder, so there will be some rise of immunoglobulin in all. There are various autoantibodies associated with different disorders, like in autoimmune hepatitis, because it is ANA, LKM1 is more associated with autoimmune hepatitis type 2. In primary biliary cirrhosis, it is anti-mitochondrial antibody, especially the one which is against pyruvate dehydrogenase, that is more specific. And for primary sclerosing cholangitis, it is P-ANCA. Another thing I wanted to mention is that LKM1, which is associated with autoimmune hepatitis type 2, that can also be present in hepatitis C. And also LC1, that can also be found in hepatitis C. And also the LKM3, that can be found in chronic hepatitis D. So these are not that specific also for autoimmune hepatitis. We have to do some clinical correlation and work up, then only we can diagnose a case of either hepatitis C or autoimmune hepatitis. Now coming to the next entity, that is drug-induced liver injury, in short, which is called DLI. Now there are six mechanisms of drug-induced liver damage. First, what happens? There is disruption of the intracellular calcium homeostasis. Now this leads to disassembly of the actin fibrils in the membrane of the hepatocyte. Ultimately, this will result in bleeding and rupture of these hepatocytes. This will cause a hepatitis-like picture. The second mechanism is the same thing is happening within the biliary canaliculus. So disruption of actin filaments and bleeding is occurring in the biliary canaliculus. So the transport channels, these are destroyed. So this will in turn give a picture of cholestasis. Now the third mechanism is the drugs are usually metabolized by cytochrome P450 system. So these are forming some drug adducts. So when these drug adducts are formed, they undergo they enter into the vesicles, and now this is acting as an antigen. So when it acts as an antigen, there can be T cell destruction of these antigens, means these drug adducts, which can in turn give rise to a picture of hepatitis. The other fifth mechanism is that activation of apoptotic pathways by the drug. And the last mechanism is that of mitochondrial damage. And the mitochondria, we know, is a site of beta oxidation and lipid metabolism. So these drugs which affect the mitochondrial system, they can give a picture of steatosis, that is fatty acid accumulation. Now, drug-induced hepatic injury, there can be direct toxic effect or idiosyncratic. Direct toxic effect means there is a dose relationship, means there is a fixed dose relationship. So we can say, like in an example of acetaminophen, if we find that, okay, 1000 milligram of paracetamol for this many days will cause this toxicity, that is acute liver failure. And this behavior is known and fixed pattern. While in idiosyncratic, nor there is any relationship to the dose. Any minimal amount of dose can also cause a toxic effect, while a very large amount of dose also might not cause any toxic effect. Also, there will be variability in the picture of toxicity. So this is the meaning of direct toxic effect and idiosyncratic effect. Some examples you can remember for direct toxic effect: acetaminophen and carbon tetrachloride, while idiosyncratic reactions are shown by isoniazid and ciprofloxacin. Now, what are the patterns of drug and toxic-induced hepatic injury? Whatever liver disease you know, you can find anything in drug induced liver injury. So you can just memorize how much you can memorize. But the important ones you should remember are the effect of contraceptive and anabolic steroids, which can cause give a picture of cholestasis, which can predispose a patient to neoplasms like hepatic adenoma or hepatocellular carcinoma, or there can be vascular lesions. Acetaminophen shows diffuse hepatocellular necrosis, and also some anticonvulsants like valproate and tetracycline, they can show microvesicular steatosis. However, the morphology is very much varied, and you think of any liver lesion, and any liver lesion can be manifested by drug-induced liver injury. So we have finished with the hepatitis. Now you can answer some of these MCQs. You can just unmute and answer. So all of the following are true about hepatitis A except, then unmute and answer, and please answer fast.
C.
Yeah, right. All of the following are liver biopsy finding of acute hepatitis B except. Anyone answering? You can take a guess also. Basically, all are features of hepatitis, but one of them is not a feature of acute hepatitis. One of them is a feature of chronic hepatitis. Which one is that? I'm asking for that. Okay, the answer is ground glass hepatocyte. Ground glass hepatocyte is a manifestation of chronic hepatitis B. It is not a manifestation of acute hepatitis. Next, which of the following is the single most important indicator of the likelihood of progression of hepatitis to liver cirrhosis? You can take a guess also. This is not an exam. And you can answer, is it the etiology? Is it the associated serological findings? Or the presence of bridging necrosis, presence of hyaluronic bodies. No one will take a guess also. Okay, it's the etiology. Main factor which determines the progression of hepatitis to liver cirrhosis is etiology, because we have seen it is mainly the hepatitis B and hepatitis C which progresses to chronic hepatitis and then to cirrhosis. Now I want to add one point which I did not say yesterday. In hepatitis B, when there is vertical transmission, that is mother to child transmission, there is 90% chance of developing chronic hepatitis B and in turn cirrhosis. Why? Because in childhood the immune system is not that much developed, so the hepatocyte learns to live with the virus. So it does not cause any damage to the virus, but as the patient ages, the immune system becomes strong, and then he can manifest with chronic liver disease and cirrhosis. Now next question. There's a 25-year person who is presenting with mild ichthyosis. His HbS-Ag is positive, HbeAg is negative, SGOT and SGPT is raised by 5 to 6 times the original value. Hepatitis B virus DNA levels are more than 1 lakh. So what would you think?
Precore mutant.
Kindly explain why you say precore mutant. Can
Ma'am, HBV DNA levels are more than 1 lakh per ml, so it is highly infectious. But HbeAg is coming negative, so HbeAg should be positive in case of highly infectious. But as it is negative, so this must be mutant.
So another point is that this type of profile can also be seen in carriers with a serologic profile, but the carriers will not show 5 to 6 times elevation of SGOT and SGPT. And also the hepatitis B virus DNA levels will be normal. So this is a precore mutant hepatitis B virus. Which of the following has been implicated in the pathogenesis of hepatocellular carcinoma in hepatitis B infection?
HBX.
Yeah, good, HBX. Now HBX protein, this told you that this has a role in the signal transduction pathways, and it causes increased proliferation of the virus. So this has a role in hepatocellular carcinoma. Now, characteristic antibodies of autoimmune hepatitis include all of the following except its anti-CCP antibodies. Anti-CCP antibodies are associated with rheumatoid arthritis. Rest all can be present. And antibody present in autoimmune hepatitis type 2, this I have repeated today also. I uttered
anti-LKM.
Yeah, anti-LKM1 antibody. And anti-mitochondrial antibody is for?
For type 1.
No, no. It is specific for something. It's specific for primary biliary It shows 95% specificity for primary biliary cholangitis, especially the pyruvate dehydrogenase E2 dominant. Now, some histories. There's a 45-year-old woman. It's a female patient. She is presenting with pruritus and icterus for 7 months. She has generalized jaundice. Lab studies show total protein and albumin is normal only. Bilirubin is raised. The direct fraction is more. AST and ALT is somewhat raised. Normal is up to 40. Alkaline phosphatase is raised. A liver biopsy specimen showed destruction of portal tracts, loss of bile ducts, and some lymphocytic infiltrate. Which of the following additional lab findings is most likely to be present in this woman? So this is a female patient having a cholestatic pattern and showing bile duct damage and loss. So what will you think?
E.
Yeah, positive antimitochondrial antibody because we are thinking in the line of primary biliary cholangitis. That is more common in female patients. Now, another scenario, there's a 43-year-old man who is again presenting with pruritus and icterus, and there's an association with ulcerative colitis. Alkaline phosphatase is raised, and there is elevated titer of ANCA. Cholangiography shows widespread intrahepatic biliary tube obliteration and bleeded appearance in the remaining ducts. So, what histological picture do you expect in this? Male gender association with ulcerative colitis, cholestatic pattern, what will you think? That is the second disease I discussed today. That is primary sclerosing cholangitis. And that will show concentric onion skinning, ductular fibrosis. Okay, now from the first day's class, true regarding unconjugated bilirubin is? Which one is true?
Four.
It is lipid soluble, that's why it can cause the blood-brain barrier. So this is false. It's not water soluble. And as it is not water soluble, it cannot be excreted by the kidney. Now, normal liver histology is seen in more than one option can be cut. It can be normal in Gilbert syndrome, Crigler-Najjar syndrome, and Rota syndrome. Among this, Gilbert syndrome and Crigler-Najjar syndrome has unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. These are causes of isolated hyperbilirubinemia. While Rota syndrome is a cause of conjugated bilirubinemia. These three will show normal liver histology. In Dubin-Johnson syndrome, I have shown you that the liver has a dark black gray color and the pigment is like that of something between lipofuscin and melanin. And hemochromatosis is a disorder of iron storage, so it will show intense pigmentation. So these three are the correct answers. So moving now to today's topic, that is steatosis. Steatosis is accumulation of fat. Now, steatosis that can be of two types, macrovesicular steatosis or microvesicular steatosis. What is macrovesicular steatosis? In this, there's a single large liquid vacuole and that will occupy the entire cytoplasm and push the nucleus to the periphery. What are the causes of macrovesicular steatosis? It can be obesity or diabetes mellitus, that is the ones which are associated with metabolic syndrome. Protein energy malnutrition or total parenteral nutrition, certain drugs like alcohol and steroids, some metabolic disorders like Wilson's disease and hepatitis C, as we have seen that it is associated with steatosis. Now, what is microvesicular steatosis? In contrast to macrovesicular, where the nucleus is pushed to the periphery, in microvesicular, the nucleus remains in the center only and the hepatocyte will show multiple tiny fat vacuoles. Now, what are the causes of microvesicular steatosis? It can be again seen in fatty liver of pregnancy, certain drugs like valproate and tetracycline, and the another important cause is the Reye syndrome. Now, Reye syndrome is a shows a manifestation of hepatic encephalopathy after any viral infection, and this usually shows microvesicular type of steatosis. Now, fat we know is not stained by HND; it gets washed off during the processing. So for identification of the fat, we need a stain, which is the oil red O stain. You can see that the fat is stained orangish in color. And how is the gross appearance? As you can see here, as compared to the healthy liver, it will appear yellowish in color. It is waxy and greasy in appearance. People do have a gross in your lab, and this is sometimes asked in exam also. So you should know the causes of steatosis. Now coming to the next entity, that is alcohol metabolism and alcoholic liver disease. Now alcohol as such is absorbed unaltered from the intestine, and from the intestine it goes into the circulation, and from circulation it is excreted via the urine, sweat, and in your breath. That forms the basis of the breath test and the drink and driving and all that. So where is alcohol metabolized? Basically in the liver only, and there are two main enzymes involved, that is alcohol dehydrogenase and aldehyde dehydrogenase. The most of the metabolism takes place within the cytoplasm. This is the major pathway. The other pathways are that of the microsomal system, where the cytochrome P system is involved, and only 5% of metabolism takes place in the peroxisomes with the help of catalase. The ultimate aim of all this is to convert ethanol to acetaldehyde, and then this acetaldehyde is converted by aldehyde dehydrogenase to acetic acid. Now, one important point to remember is that the cytochrome system in the microsome, that is also involved in various drug metabolisms. So, if alcohol does is it can increase the metabolism of those drugs. Now, another thing which can happen is if the alcohol concentration is too much, it can compete with those drugs for its metabolism. So, in that case, increased amount of drugs will be required to bring the desired effect. So there can be a drug interaction in case of alcohol, in case of alcoholism also. Now, what are the other effects which can happen in case of alcoholism? Now, what happens is, because this ALDH, that is aldehyde dehydrogenase, brings down the concentration of NAD by converting into NADH. Now, what will happen? This will decrease the fatty acid oxidation, and this leads to the finding of steatosis in case of alcoholic hepatitis. Now, another thing which happens is it will decrease the conversion of lactate to pyruvate, and this in turn will cause lactic acidosis. Now, another thing which happens is that this microsomal system, this generates reactive oxygen species. Now, this reactive oxygen species, this causes lipid peroxidation of hepatocyte membranes. That is, it damages the membranes of the hepatocyte. Another thing which happens is that within the intestine, there is release of polysaccharide from gram-negative bacteria, from that of intestinal flora. So this in turn increases the tumor necrosis factor and other cytokines from the macrophages and Kupffer cells. Now when these are released, this can also lead to hepatic injury. What are the mechanisms? This acetaldehyde, which is a toxic compound, this can induce lipid peroxidation and cause damage to the cytoskeletal membrane of the hepatocytes. I have already discussed the cytochrome metabolism. This can produce reactive oxygen species, and this can in turn damage the cellular protein and bring about apoptosis of the hepatocytes. Another thing which happens is it impairs the hepatic metabolism of methionine. So this impairment of methionine decreases the glutathione levels also. And glutathione, we know, is an antioxidant. So when an antioxidant level goes down, the oxidative injury will increase. So in turn, this will damage the endoplasmic reticulum. Now the effect of alcohol is dependent on certain factors also. It has been seen the women gender, they are more susceptible to the effects of alcoholism. Now why this is so? Now women, we know, are having increased level of estrogen. This increases the gut permeability to endotoxins. Now this endotoxins, what happened, this binds to the lipopolysaccharide receptor in a certain receptor called CD14, which is expressed on the Kupffer cells. Now when they bind, they will stimulate the toll-like receptor 4, and this will in turn release some cytokines and chemokines, and this can cause the damage of the hepatocytes. Also, there can be certain ethnic and genetic differences. Now this genetic variation can be seen in the alcohol detoxifying enzymes like the aldehyde dehydrogenase. Now, if this certain variant, it has been seen to be present in 50% of the Asians, And if this variant is present, this type of variant has a very low enzyme activity. So if it has a very low enzyme activity, the acetaldehyde, which is formed by the action of alcohol dehydrogenase, that cannot be converted into acetic acid. So this accumulation of acetaldehyde, this will give rise to acute effects of alcohol like flushing. Means the body cannot tolerate alcohol at all. Also, if there are associated some comorbid conditions, like the patient is having non-alcoholic steatosis or some hepatitis because of hepatitis B or C, this can in turn cause increased damage in case of alcoholism. Now, what is the morphological spectrum of alcoholism? First and foremost, in 90 to 95% cases, there will be only steatosis. There will be no inflammation. Now, if it is prolonged, there will be inflammation also, which is called as steatohepatitis. Now, after steatohepatitis, there will be the stellate cells will be activated, and ultimately there will be fibrosis. After fibrosis, if the fibrosis goes for long duration, it will lead to cirrhosis, and if the stimulus is still continuing, then it can be development of hepatocellular carcinoma. So this is the photomicrograph of only steatosis. We can see only some fat globules. There is no inflammation whatsoever. The next step is, if it is prolonged, there is steatohepatitis. There is steatosis as well as inflammation. Now, in alcoholic hepatitis, we can see neutrophilic infiltration. And the neutrophilic infiltration is seen around the hepatocytes. This is called neutrophilic satellitosis. So finding neutrophil in a liver biopsy should raise a suspicion of an alcoholic liver disease. And you can take a history whether the patient is alcoholic or not. Now, another thing which is fine is the Mallory Hyaline bodies. In case of alcohol, this is the thick, ropey, this is intermediate filament-like structure which is found in alcoholic liver disease, but it is not specific for alcoholic liver disease. We will see in the next slide. Now, if the disease is prolonged, there is laying down of the fibrous strand of collagen type 1 and 3, as we can see in this Mason striatum. So this type of fibrosis, this is called the perisinusoidal or pericellular fibrosis. It is usually seen around the central vein, and you will see that single hepatocytes are surrounded by the fibrous strand. So this is perisinusoidal or pericellular fibrosis. And ultimately, if the disease is long-standing, there will be cirrhosis, there will be nodule formation, there will be intense damage, after which there will be degenerative nodule formation, which will be separated by fibrous septa. Now, a word about Mallory Hyaline. Mallory Hyaline, these are actually disintegrated or degraded intermediate filaments. They are stained by cytokeratin 8 and 18. You should know the causes where one can find Mallory Hyaline. It is not specific for any disease. It can be found in alcoholic liver disease. Apart from that, it can also be found in non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. It can be found in Wilson's disease. It can be found in primary biliary cirrhosis. It is not found in secondary biliary cirrhosis. It is found in Indian childhood cirrhosis. It can be found in tumors like hepatocellular carcinoma. It can be found in any cholestatic disorder, and it can be also found in alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. So knowing Mallory Hyaline is important for your neurology point of view. Now, coming to the next entity, that is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Now, what is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease? There will be presence of hepatic steatosis, like that of alcoholism. But in this patient, there will be no history of alcohol consumption, or even if it is there, it will be in small quantities. And there should not be any other association with any other disease which can cause steatosis, like hepatitis C virus, Wilson's disease, or medications. Now, this is a very upcoming topic for research, and because of the change in lifestyle of human beings, and this is associated with the metabolic syndrome. Now, how we define metabolic syndrome? One of these features should be present. Either the patient should be suffering from diabetes mellitus or impaired glucose tolerance, or impaired fasting glucose, or insulin resistance. So any one of this, and any two of the biochemical features or clinical features, like blood pressure, high blood pressure, the patient is having dyslipidemia, the patient is having central obesity, or the patient is having microalbuminuria, that is some kidney dysfunction. So one of these features and two of these features will put a patient in a category of suffering from metabolic syndrome. What is the pathogenesis in this? There are basically two main causes. One, apart from genetic modifiers, one is this insulin resistance. Now, insulin we know is an anabolic hormone. It causes lipogenesis, it causes gluconeogenesis. So if there is insulin resistance, means the body is not responding to insulin, there will be the opposite effect. That is, there will be peripheral lipolysis, which will also cause increase in circulating fatty acids. Now, the another thing is because of the dietary modifications and our lifestyle, there can be excess carbohydrate intake, which can cause de novo lipogenesis. So the end result of all of this is increase in hepatocellular free fatty acids. Now, the body tries to remove these fatty acids either by oxidative process like peroxisomal oxidation or mitochondrial oxidation, or it will be converted by triglyceride and then excreted as VLDL. If the amount is excess, then it is converted to lipid droplets and there will be only steatosis. Now, if these mechanisms are overwhelmed, there is formation of lipotoxic metabolites, and this lipotoxic metabolites is causes endoplasmic reticulum stress, apoptosis, and necrosis. So this forms the basis of non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. Means apart from steatosis, there will be inflammation also. The morphological features will be like that of alcoholic steatosis and steatotic hepatitis only. Now, what is the fate of these patients? Now, if you identify these patients, usually they are young patients. If you find isolated fatty liver, if there is dietary modification, lifestyle modification, these patients can revert back to normal. However, in 20% of cases, there can be a development of inflammation, that is steatohepatitis, and within them also 20% can undergo fibrosis, and less than 1% can progress to hepatocellular carcinoma. So it is very essential to identify non-alcoholic steatohepatitis in because these are more prevalent in young patients. I'll not go into the detail. There is some grading system and staging system. The grading system is based on how much is the steatosis, because some amount of steatosis can be found in patients. So more than 5% is considered abnormal. We grade the ballooning, we grade the inflammation, and grade the fibrosis also. Like when there is only perivenular fibrosis, this is stage 1. There is periportal plus central fibrosis, this is stage 2. And when there is bridging fibrosis and formation of nodules, this is stage 4. Now coming to the next topic, that is liver failure. Now liver failure can be acute, chronic, or acute on chronic. Acute means due to sudden and massive hepatic destruction. Means the liver is not getting any time to react only. There is a sudden insult, like in case of paracetamol poisoning. And then there is a chronic, means following years of insidious injury, like in case of hepatitis B or any long-standing disease, the patient is getting some time to recover. So there will be a formation of some regenerative nodules, and this is long-standing. Another thing is acute on chronic, means the patient is suffering from chronic hepatitis, but there is some acute insult. If the patient has taken paracetamol, it is causing some acute insult on the chronic disease. Now, what are the causes? The most common causes, especially in the Western world, is the paracetamol poisoning. However, in India, it is mainly the viral infections like hepatitis B or the autoimmune hepatitis. Now, there can be vascular causes also, like shock. There can be various metabolic disorders like Wilson's disease, fatty liver of pregnancy, autoimmune hepatitis. And the reason can be unknown also. In about 15 to 20% of adult cases, the reason of acute liver failure is unknown. And in children, about 50% of the cases is unknown. This is a photomicrograph of showing acute liver injury. You can see large zones of necrosis in this. And you can see large excess karyotectin tape disease. There is extensive damage of the hepatocellular parenchyma in case of acute liver failure. Now, what are the clinical features associated with this? Now, first of all, it will manifest with nausea, vomiting, jaundice, like any other hepatitis, followed by life-threatening disorders like encephalopathy and coagulation defects. Now, as there is extensive damage of the hepatocytes, liver transaminases will be markedly elevated. Next is, initially there is hepatomegaly. Obviously, because of inflammation, there will be hepatocellular swelling, there will be inflammatory infiltrate, edema, But as the disease process goes on, the hepatocytes will burst and release the enzyme. This will be followed by liver shrinkage because of destruction of the parenchyme. So this will give a false decline of, there will be false decline of serum transaminases, because the liver has exhausted itself after liberating all the serum transaminases. So one can get a false impression that, the patient is improving, but the patient is not improving. Actually, the patient is deteriorating, which will be highlighted by his symptoms, not by the enzyme profile. So if this process goes longer and uncontrolled, then there can be multiple organ dysfunction. Now, the other feature which can be present is cholestasis. Obviously, when there is hepatic injury, the adjoining canaliculi will also be destroyed. This can lead to alteration of bile formation, and this will lead to cholestasis. Now, another important manifestations which are associated with liver failure is hepatic encephalopathy. I discussed in your first lecture that ammonia is metabolized only in the liver because the Krebs-Hensel-Hensel cycle is only present in the liver. Now, whatever ammonia is derived from the dietary sources, it is metabolized in the liver. So if the liver is only not functioning, it has been damaged completely, it can bypass the liver and it can reach the brain. Also, what happens when there is a liver failure because of cirrhosis, means the blood cannot flow into the liver because of fibrosis, but the blood will try alternate routes to develop circulation. So it develops photosystemic shunts. So the ammonia can reach to photosystemic shunt also in the brain. In the brain, the astrocytes again convert this ammonia into glutamine. Now, glutamine, we know this has got excitatory role in brain, and also it can absorb water, so it causes edema and intracranial hypertension, and also the patient will be irritated. So how the patient will manifest? The manifestation is in the various form. It will be like disturbed consciousness, personality change, and gradually the patient will progress to coma and death. Now, another feature how you can elicit this hepatic encephalopathy is by eliciting flapping tremors, which is also called asterixis. So in this the patient is asked to dorsiflex his fingers and the patient will show flapping movement. This will be discussed more in medicine classes. I will discuss. Now next is as this chronic liver injury and liver damage, the coagulation factors will be affected. So we know the coagulation factors, all factors except for fibrinogen and factor 8, they will decrease production of coagulation factors. But it is not that only the coagulation factors are deranged. The anticoagulant proteins that are also produced in liver, so they will also be deranged. But somewhat the homeostatic balance is preserved, that liver, that bleeding doesn't occur. However, if any of this overpowers, suppose that the production of coagulation factors is much more markedly decreased as compared to decrease of anticoagulants, then there can be bleeding manifestations, which will be seen in like increased PD and APDD. And also there can be dysfibrinogenemia, there will be impaired polymerization of fibrin. So though the fibrinogen level is normal, but its quality is not good. That is, this is dysfibrinogenemia. So the fibrinogen cannot be converted to fibrin, so this can also lead to coagulation defects. And also there is increase of tissue plasminogen activator. This also causes fibrinolysis, so this also can break the clot. Also there can be thrombocytopenia. Why? Because when there is development of portal hypertension, there is development of congestive splenomegaly. And whenever there is splenomegaly, spleen is the site where the blood cells are sequestered. So platelet can also be sequestered, and this can lead to thrombocytopenia. And also thrombopoietin is also produced in the liver, so the level can go down. So there can be various manifestations. It can be bleeding also, and there can also be thrombosis also. It can be either. Now coming to hepatorenal syndrome. Now what happens in hepatorenal syndrome? As we can see, the development of cirrhosis and fibrosis, which leads to hepatic failure, this will give rise to intrahepatic resistance. Means the blood cannot flow into the inner fibrotic structure, so intrahepatic resistance will increase. Now to compensate for this, the body will try to push excess blood into the liver, as the liver is not receiving adequate amount of blood. So it will release certain substances like nitric oxide, prostaglandin, which causes systemic vasodilatation. Now this systemic vasodilatation, this the body, when there is vasodilatation, means less amount of blood will be pumped into the heart. So the kidney will also not receive adequate amount of blood. So when the kidney doesn't receive adequate amount of blood, the renin-angiotensin system gets activated, and also the sympathetic nervous system will get activated, and there will be increased release of vasopressin. Now what will this cause? This cause more vasoconstriction, so this will in turn decrease the blood flow, and also this causes water retention. This will be manifested in the form of oliguria and urea. Next, what is hepatopulmonary syndrome? What happens in hepatopulmonary syndrome? Again, because of liver disease due to cirrhosis and focal hypertension, certain factors are released from the liver, like TGF-beta-1 and endothelin. So these are vasoconstrictors. Now, in response of these vasoconstrictors, the blood vessels will try to dilate also. So there will be secretion of nitric oxide synthase, which will increase nitric oxide. So there will be vasodilatation. Now, when there is vasodilatation, as we can see, normally if the lung capillary is 8 micrometer, all the RBCs are adequately oxygenated. Now, when there is vasodilatation, we can see obviously there will be increased amount of RBCs, but they will not be adequately oxygenated. So the patient will manifest with hypoxemia, and also there can be clubbing. So this is hepatopulmonary syndrome. Now, what happens in chronic liver failure? In chronic liver failure, apart from the above manifestations like hepatic encephalopathy, hepatopulmonary syndrome, hepatorenal syndrome, there will be development of parenchymal nodules because of ongoing insult and regeneration. And other things which happens are the persistent cholestasis, and also the we know that the steroids, the anabolic steroids or the estrogen, which are metabolized in the liver. So this will not be metabolized, so there will be manifestations of hyperestrogenemia, which can be seen in the form of Palmar edema or spider angioma. In spider angioma, we can see a dilated arteriole in the center with numerous radiating vessels. So these are usually found around the chest. Apart from that, there will be hypogonadism and gynecomastia in case of AIDS. Next, coming to cirrhosis. Now, cirrhosis, it represents irreversible end stage of severe diffuse diseases. Means any long-standing liver disease can cause cirrhosis. It involves the entire liver. There will be disorganized normal lobular architecture of hepatic parenchyma. There will be formation of nodules which are separated from one another by irregular band of fibrosis. And it occurs following hepatocellular necrosis of varying etiology. And so there will be alternate areas of necrosis and regenerative nodules. As we can see in this histology photograph, in an HND section, you can see nodules which are well demarcated by fibrous bands, which can be better appreciated in Mason's trichrome. You can see these regenerative nodules, which are separated by this Mason's trichrome fibrous bands. Now, what is the mechanism? Now, in the first class, I have shown you that there's a space of descent in between the endothelial lining sinusoidal endothelial cells, which line the sinusoids, and the hepatocytes. In this, we have the hepatic cells of steroid cells of E2. Now what happens in this, the Kupffer cells get activated. They secrete various factors like platelet-derived growth factor, which causes proliferation of these stellate cells, hepatic stellate cells. They release some factors like endothelin, which brings about the contraction. And also certain chemotaxic factors are released, which causes apoptosis. Now this, when there's proliferation of these hepatic stellate cells, they are changed to myofibroblast, and this leads to laying down of this fibrous strands in case of cirrhosis. Now, grossly, there is micronodular cirrhosis when the nodules are less than 3 millimeter in diameter, and the nodules are usually retinal, as can be seen in this photo micrograph. You can see this tiny tiny nodule. If you should remember some of the causes, especially hemochromatosis, you usually find micronodular cirrhosis in hemochromatosis. Apart from that, micronodular cirrhosis can be found in Indian childhood cirrhosis or biliary obstruction. Macronodular cirrhosis, the nodules are more than 3 millimeter in size, and they are of various configuration. and the causes associated are the late stage of alcoholic cirrhosis or Wilson's disease. There's an etiology classification also. In etiology, basically all the liver disease which can cause chronic liver disease comes, like alcoholic cirrhosis, biliary cirrhosis, cirrhosis in hemochromatosis, cirrhosis in Wilson's disease, alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency. These are basically metabolic disorder which are usually long-standing. Then autoimmune hepatitis, non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, cryptogenic cirrhosis, where the cause is not known. Now, a word about biliary cirrhosis. Biliary cirrhosis means there is the conditions are related to the bile duct. Now, whenever there is bile duct damage, we know that there is cholestasis. So, the cholestasis gives rise to this greenish color in case of biliary cirrhosis. Now, another differentiating point is that while the other cirrhosis show regular down nodules which are separated by fibrous strands, in biliary cirrhosis, we describe this sort of cirrhosis as a jigsaw puzzle cirrhosis. You can see irregular nodules which are interconnected. So, this is biliary cirrhosis. Now, what are the complications and pathogenesis of cirrhosis? Now, pathogenesis, as we can have seen, it can be infectious, it can be autoimmune, it can be toxin related, it can be metabolic, or it can be some genetic disorder. So this will lay down to scarring and laying down of fibrous strands, which will cause cirrhosis. Now, what will be the effects of cirrhosis? One is there will be increased resistance to blood flow, support to fibrotic liver, which will lead to portal hypertension. Now, the manifestations of portal hypertension, I will discuss in our next lecture, which is already 1 o'clock. Hepatocellular carcinoma can be present in 85% of the cases, and also there will be complications of liver insufficiency, like decreased albumin, hypoalbuminemia, we know causes edema. There will be coagulation, a deficiency of coagulation factors, so this can manifest either in the form of bleeding or increased coagulopathy. There can be encephalopathy, and because of liver failure, and also there can be manifestations like after bile duct damage, there can be jaundice and scleral ictus. So I will.